Is it recording right now?
So, can you tell us a little bit about your early life?
I was born in 1933, that year when Hitler came to power. We had a fairly comfortable life at home. My father had a very comfortable business. And in 1939, the first day World War II broke up, out in 1939, September 1st, that was the first time I went to school. I remember it this way. I went to, there was a Jewish elementary school in the town where I lived. That's not Budapest, Romania, Hungary, but another called Page. After that, after the elementary school, I went to a parochial school. Mm-hmm. I learned all the Catholic liturgy and everything. I knew most of it. But at the same time, that was the best school in that place. In 1944, March 19, the Germans came in to Hungary. And they occupied the whole country. And that's when the Jewish problem started. We had to start wearing yellow stars. Mm-hmm. And most of the time we had to be very careful because the Germans, they didn't have to account for any life. If they decided that they want to shoot somebody, they would shoot. They would do. They didn't have to account for anybody. Anyway, in 1944, around May, they put us into a ghetto, you know, where you put everybody together. Mm-hmm. We stayed there until July 6. In the ghetto life, we had enough food for that. And being a Boy Scout at that time, there was a Jewish Boy Scout group, we still played the Boy Scouts in the ghetto to keep us occupied. And that was the preliminary of the problems. That's when the problem started. In 1944, July 6, they put us into cattle cars. 70 in a car, in the cattle car. Just one bucket for anything that you had to do. For 3 days, there was no food, no water, just that. The moment we arrived in Auschwitz-Birkenau, that's the biggest death camp that ever existed in the world. Mm-hmm. They took us out from the cattle cars, lined us up. Men who can work one side, women and children to the other side. Mm-hmm. I was already in the line for the gas chamber with my family. My mother, my sister, my grandmother, cousins, uncles, aunts, everybody. In the line for the gas chamber. Mm-hmm. Came around Dr. Mengele, I don't know if you heard that name. Yeah. And asked for twins. And my mother didn't know what to do and what to say. She stayed quiet. The second time, they again didn't say anything. The third time said, yes, I have twins. They took us right away. I never saw my mother anymore, nobody. And that was the last time I saw all the family.
How old were you at the
11. Although, there's an also funny thing about it. My mother said to us, say 9, then maybe they will keep us together. She didn't know what's going to happen, but in order to keep the whole family together, say, you're 9 years old. Mengele found it very funny that we are tall and got big, but we stayed for the whole 8 or 9 months that we were over there, we were 9-year-olds. Hmm. And we kept it. Anyway, there came an ambulance and took us right away into the lager. The barrack, I have to think. And the first thing, they gave us the number. That was the first thing. And it was a German political prisoner who was in charge of that block. He wasn't even Jewish. So they gave us the, and since we haven't eaten anything basically during the whole trip, and when I saw what they gave us to eat, I couldn't eat. I couldn't for 1 or 2 days, I couldn't eat. Afterwards, you know, hunger. Mm-hmm. Hunger conquers everything. And we just ate whatever they gave us. We asked, there was a twin, an older twin, Mengele, decided that since he was an officer in the Czech army, he was in charge of all the kids, and because they were all young children, mm-hmm. From 16, 17 up to 8 years old, they were twins over there. And he was in charge, and they asked him, "When can I see my mother and my family?" And then he said, "Look up over there, you see the flames?
At such a young age, how did you, and I know your brother,
yes.
like, cope with everything that was going on?
I was always, all my life, I was an optimist. I said, I'm going to survive. I'm going to make it. That's the only way you can do it. You think about it, you go through it, and you, being an optimist, you will survive. I can say in a funny way, cats have 9 lives. I'm not a cat, but if I would have, I used up 3 already. The first time, when I was in the line for the gas chamber when they arrived, mm-hmm. and I was pulled out from it. Second time later, sometimes in October in 1944, another doctor, not Dr. Mengele, but another doctor decided that the kids not needed anymore and selected us, closed the barrack, and we knew that the next day we are be eliminated. Somehow, by chance, we survived. I think Dr. Mengele found out something about it. He says, I'm not finished with my experiments yet. Because he was doing experiments on twins. And the third time when the Russians came too fast and they wanted to empty their lagers and we were supposed to go into the forest to be shot, all of us. The Russians came too fast and they disappeared. Because they, when they lined us up and the end of the line, people who couldn't walk, they were shot on the spot. We shot them. Life was cheap. They didn't. Mm-hmm. They didn't care. They didn't amount to anything. And the idea was to eliminate everybody, to kill everybody. Mm-hmm. When the Germans were losing the war in early 1944, and Stalingrad was already where the Germans got the biggest defeat. They still used trains to carry the people to the gas chamber, to the camps. Mm. They still, it wasn't enough for them that they're losing the war, they still wanted to kill everybody. Mm-hmm. That was their mentality. So I was there from July 9th till January 27th when we are. The life over there, fairly monotonous. There was sometimes a little bit of better things. For instance, our lager at the end was a soccer field. We used to play with children, being children, rag balls, we kicked around there. And once in a while, there was a soccer match with the German soldiers and some inmates. Yeah. I don't know how they do it, I think twice. Huh.
Wow.
Yeah. Otherwise, you get up early in the morning, 5 o'clock, go outside, rain, shine, cold, anything. They had to count us. Every morning, 5 o'clock, you had to line up in front of the barrack, line up and being counted. Now, I don't know why, because it didn't matter if somebody was in the shot already, they didn't count, but that was the daily routine. The other daily routine was that being a block where most of the sick people was a certain other block. Mm-hmm. There was 1, 2, 3. The third one was full of men, emaciated, looks like skin and bone. And every morning they put out, I think, 7, 8, or 9 bodies, like Lincoln logs. They put 3 like that, 3 like that, and then came with a cart and tipped it away. And they didn't even bother to put it in the crematorium. There was a big
pit.
You know, sometimes she helps because I'm looking for some pit, and just threw them in the burning pit.
Wow.
I seen enough death for the rest of my life. Mm-hmm. Because you don't need more. The gas chamber. I didn't see it, but from knowing some people some testimonies from other people who did work it, that they said that, and there's always in my mind, the people were, all of them had to undress totally, men, men, women, children, older people, put them into the gas chamber.
They were told they're
carrying
a shower.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to say, that to take a shower, so because we, and suddenly they put the gas in. My, in front of my eyes, always one thing. They said that the gas on the bottom started first, and then started people jump on top of each other until they go to the end, like a pyramid, because that's how they all died. And I was always in my flat. Did my mother stay down? Because she wasn't a fighter. My sister, my grandmother. It's always in the front of my eyes. And luckily, the Russians, the daily life was, you never knew when they were going to get you.
Mm-hmm.
They never,
that's some of the experiments.
Oh yes, Mengele did some experiments on us. The first time Mengele was wondering how come you are so big, but you are only 9 years old. And then they started measuring, taking blood, giving injections. I will never find out what was out of it. What did they get out of it? It was such an experience, it doesn't make a thing. It doesn't make a sense. I think they thought that if they checked the twins, maybe they can find out some way to make more twins so the German people multiply much faster. I don't know what, this one is absolutely useless. Unfortunately, some other twins got very bad. Some of them earlier, I was one of the last ones to arrive, and only after us, only another pair came in. But the earlier experiments, sometimes they killed one of them, gave injections, showing that, and then opened up and get the twin and open up and see what's the difference between them. And I don't know what, there was no rhyme or reason to do something like that. But the thing is that the only thing that you always said, is my number coming up or not? Is my number coming up or not? Luckily, I'm here. It was 8 or 9 months, absolute misery. The food, I went to hungry every day, every night. This belly here, something that is not supposed to be there. I tell you something. I always say, I starved because there was not enough food. Then I got married, and my wife and my mother-in-law fed me up, and I started dieting, and I was starving because there was too much food. In the end, I said, to hell with it. I enjoy my life. Enjoy it, and that's why I have that with it.
So you told us that the 70th anniversary of your liberation was last Tuesday.
That's correct.
So once you were liberated, how did you restart your life?
Okay, that's... But I saw the first Russian soldiers, I said, finally, I'm free. And we had that the man who was in charge of all of us, and we asked him, please, start right away, take us away from here, because if the Germans by any chance come back, we will not make it. So, next day, as soon as we put together ourselves, next day we started moving from Auschwitz to Krakow. This is, I don't know in kilometers or miles how much, it's about 60 or 70 miles. For 2 days and nights we walked. It was colder than today here. It was damn cold. No food, because there was nobody who would give us a food. Right after the liberation, some people started going into German places. There was some food or something. By the time I got over there, there was only a bottle of water I could take. And that bottle of water, I put it in my sack, and it was so cold that it froze and all broke up, and I was totally icy. And I walked for 2 days icy. We arrived in Krakow, and I still remember the address, 37 Ulica. And that's when our mentor, the man who was in charge of us, tried to look for places, because he spoke, he was from Hungary's northern border, close to the Russian border. And he spoke, and he was also Czech and Russian, so he was able to talk and find a place where could, once a day we got some food. But on the other hand, once in a day time I started walking the streets, went into houses and begged for a slice of bread. We are hungry. And right after we were liberated, that Krakow, the big city, was also liberated, and the people over there also didn't have enough food. So it was a misery all around for everybody. Somehow, I think about 7 or 10 days later, he found some way, transportation, to start moving east. The first one, we got a flat wagon, when they used to carry their tanks on the railroad, and that was open. It was damn cold, but at least we started moving east. Closer to Hungary, went through most of Poland. At one point, we had to get out from the trains, and because that train stopped, we went through a city. There was not one house standing. It was a big city. I don't remember the name anymore, but there was not one house standing. We walked through the whole place, nothing. I didn't even see people there. Later on, he found another way and another train. He went very close to the Russian border, and then he turned around and he went down to Hungary. It's a sort of recollection because it's more than 70 years.
Yeah, no problem.
I know that there was there a Jewish place already, and they gave us food. I ate, and from there, a train ride from that point in Hungary, Eastern Hungary, all the way to Budapest. Oh. I emptied myself out. Yeah, no food, and they gave me chicken soup, very fat chicken soup.
Mm.
Besides that, I was full of lice, because there was no way we could clean ourselves anywhere. I was full of lice, and somebody at the train looked at me and went like this. I said, you're not missing, because wherever you touch, you always have lice. Mm. We arrived in Budapest. Somebody, I don't know, they found out that some people came back, because we were the very first from a death camp that survived, that came back, and it was all children. Somebody found out, and a man, my neighbor from down in the city where I lived, the neighbor, next door neighbor, whom he knew very well, he says, I know there are some twins in here. Let's see if these are our neighbor. And we found us. And at that time in Budapest, my grandmother's sister, who lived over there, was still alive. And they took us over there. We stayed over there a day or two until the transportation came down to my place, Page, in Hungary.
Mm.
So you and your brother were together throughout this entire...
All the time. When we arrived over there, somebody took us up to the secret police in Budapest. To the place, I don't know, to give testimony. Because we were the very first who arrived. The very, very first who survived children.
Most children were killed.
Yeah. And one of the guys gave me a reason, why don't you start, that's a bad guy, start hitting. I just don't want to do anything like that. I wanted to be left alone. Anyway, went back to some transportation. I got back home. Our house was already in shambles because some Russian soldiers took it over, and everything was on the floor. Mutz, can you bring me those pictures, two pictures, please? I found some pictures on the floor, and I'll show you the.
How do you feel about Germans now?
I tell you something.
Is it okay?
Yeah. This is the picture I found on the floor. This is my family.
This one?
That's me.
This one?
Yeah.
The cute ones.
What do you
Thank you.
And this is my bigger family, out of which this man, my uncle, survived. And my father, who survived Dachau, which is another concentration camp, and my brother.
Your brother's name is Thomas.
That's correct. And out of this whole family picture, only him and brother.
Wow.
That's all that's left.
Would you say your relationship with your brother got stronger?
Yeah, it's okay. That's good. Yeah. He's in Toronto right now. And this is the picture they took, my uncle took, when we arrived. That picture appeared in the Life magazine and a lot of other places.
Wow. So this was after everything?
When we arrived.
Wow.
Right back to Hungary.
You know, a lot of people go through, it's not like, traumatic isn't even a good enough word to cover what you went through and what you saw. It was, I can't even describe it. Why did you decide to open up and speak about it? Because I know you have talked to many people. I know you're in the Holocaust Museum. Why did you decide that it was good for you to be able to open up and speak about what happened?
I'll tell you something. For 30 or 40 years, I couldn't even talk to my children about it. I wasn't able. Then one day, my wife bought the Life magazine. And there was that picture in it from the man who survived, who was taken us everywhere. That man was interviewed and showed this picture over there. And that was in the Life magazine. And that's when we started. What happened the first, I wanted to find that man. I know that he lived in Israel. So I wrote to the Israeli embassy in Washington and asked them, give me the address for these people. They turned up, there was five with the same name. So what we did, my wife helped me. She's always helping me. She helped me to write five letters. Would the right person please? He came. He answered that he next year sometimes he will be in Brookline because his daughter is there and his son who is in Texas is getting married, that he will be around. So we met over there. And that's when started a little bit talking.
And what was his name?
Spiegel. Sweet Spiegel.
And then someone started for the surviving twins, a group. Yeah. And that started.
So we know about the organization Candles?
Yes,
right. Tell us about that?
At one time I was friendly with Eva Kaur, who was who's running this candle thing. But later on
you disagree with her thoughts.
Yeah. Anyway.
She was looking and she found the surviving twins. Because everyone thought they are the only ones who survived. But there were about 112 twins alive.
But
it's also their responsibility because they're getting older to be the last eyewitnesses.
That's the only thing where I'm talking. That's, and anyway, going back to the, I went back to school.
Well, she was asking you why you're doing it now, why you're talking about it.
Talking because I'm the last one, probably some of the very last ones still arrive. I'm only 81 right now, but there are a lot of people who's just dying out, naturally. And being eyewitness to everything, I'm supposed, I'd like to talk about it and like to tell people what was happening. And really, it's not a story, it's not a imagination, it's really happened, because I was there.
Spread awareness and teach, and to spread awareness about what happened and teach people that this is real, this is what happened.
And it shouldn't happen again.
And the ones he talks to, like you guys, it's he's passing the baton on to you that there shouldn't be any hatred and there shouldn't be any discrimination.
I'm not a very good speaker.
No, but that's the.
Yeah, that's the main main
because
reason.
Because it's difficult for him to talk about it, but he feels responsible as an eyewitness to prove it that yes,
to people's cruelty. That's the one thing that you can't imagine what kind of cruelty went through all these things. What happened not only in Auschwitz or Bergen-Belsen and the other places, even Eisenhower, who visited one of the camps, he said that it's impossible to imagine what happened over there. And if somebody starts to deny it, I am here to tell you, because I saw it. It was Eisenhower.
And how do you feel about the way that the world in general remembers and
some of them denying
about
it.
Yeah.
Some of them denying it. And the others say they're trying to forget and it just never happened. But I'm here to tell that yes, it did happen because I'm an eyewitness to all this.
And we are going to take away from this full-heartedly how important it is to spread love and not treat people like they're not people.
That's right. How should I say it? I'm thinking about the right word because it sometimes doesn't come to me. Anyway, it's no use to deny it, what a lot of people say. And really, it shouldn't happen. It's one of the worst atrocities that happened in the whole world. And that place was a death factory. It didn't matter anything if somebody they put a pistol and put it they shot you the next day. He didn't have to account for life. Nobody had to account for life. And it happened not only to Jewish people, but there was some gypsies that they killed all the gypsies that was next to my lager over there. There were some Russian prisoners. In the last week before the Russians came in, those people were shot right next to us. And also there was the highlight of the time when I was still in there, when they blew up one of the crematorium. I don't know if there is a there was a Hollywood movie about it. I saw it a long, long time ago. But at least that was one resistance that happened in there. Mm. They blew up one of the crematoriums. And it was as close to me as right over there. I saw it. Do you guys have any other questions? Because then I go and tell you what's happened afterwards.
I'm curious about how you got to America. And
okay, I'll tell you the story. 1949. First of all, I went back to school and it was still anti-Semitic. They will not stop being anti-Semitic. So I didn't feel very good, even in the school after I was already back. So in 1949, I was in a Zionist group, and We escaped Hungary, where my brother and myself escaped, went first to Czechoslovakia, because there was already a group prepared to get us. Went from Czechoslovakia to Bratislava, Vienna. We stayed in Vienna for a week or so. Mm-hmm. Then went to Salzburg, down to Italy, Trani, until in Bari, there was an Israeli ship that picked us up and to Israel. Israel became a nation May 15, 1948. I was there May 16, 1949. Because I was still young, I was 16 at that time, they took us into a kibbutz where most of the young children were. All the three, most of those kids were Hungarian, that they lost mother and father, so they were, how do you say it? Arvo.
Orphans.
Sometimes. They were all orphans. And we started a kibbutz life. I don't know if you ever heard of a kibbutz, but it's a collective farm, basically. Everybody had to get a job. It was first time we were picking bananas and some other thing. Later on, my job became a cowboy, as they say. I was milking cows for 2 years. Started 2 o'clock in the morning, 10 o'clock in the morning, and 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Three times a day. Not every time, but most of the time. And we didn't have machines yet, so everything was with hand. Anyway, I stayed in that kibbutz for 2 years. On my birthday, the 18th birthday, a week later I was in the army, because everybody had to go into the army. I was first in basic training, then they put me in a place in Jerusalem for a week or so, and then they assigned me to a place called Abu Ghosh. It was an Arab town, Arabs. And my job was to keep all the neighboring kibbutzes and the moshavs and everything, locals, to keep a count of it, because every year everybody had to go at least once for a month back to service, military service. Reservists, all of them reservists. And that was my job. And then they came out with an order that if I was already a sergeant, I worked myself up. And they said, if you are a sergeant, you have to go in a course where military, fighting sergeant. I said, I don't want to let them just. My father was an officer in the Austro-Hungarian army. Mm-hmm. I will be an officer also. And I went to the officer school. I finished it. It was 2 years. And I started working. And in 1956. In the meantime, my father and my stepmother came also to Israel, but my father, he couldn't build up a new life. He built up already when he was first, then he came back from Dachau and built it up again, the business. First the Germans took it away before the war, during the war, after the Russians take it away. He came to Israel also, and they couldn't find himself. Also, he said to himself, I lost my wife, I lost my daughter, I have my 2 sons. Life is not easy over there, and every day something could have happened. I don't want you to be around here that long. I was there 7 years. So our aim was to go at least somewhere in Canada. But the way to get over there, first I was in England for 2 years. Mm. From there, we went to Canada. I met my darling wife. We are married 53 years.
Wow.
I worked over there. I learned in Israel, learned at one time to have a general occupation. I was an automobile electrician. With this job, I could get anywhere a job. Anywhere I go in the world, I could get a job for it. And I did. Did it all the time. And in Canada, I lived 1 year in Toronto and 11 years in Montreal. That's where we got married. That's when my kids were born, a daughter and a son and a daughter first. And we stayed there over there till 1970. Then your parents, my wife's parents, say...
They wanted to separate Quebec and Lysander. He had enough of wars and revolutions.
French separatists started
to separate from Canada.
Anyway, we moved on here. I got an offer I couldn't refuse, as they say. And ever since I'm here, since 1970.
What was that?
And
you have lovely grandsons.
Thank you, I know.
And I have another one who is 20.
Oh, from
my sons.
My sons. Anyway,
that's a proof that they didn't manage to kill all the Jews, because that's the key. Mm.
Yeah. What they was laughing about?
Someone to you.
Anyway, this is in shorts. My life. So if you have guys any questions going back to any part, please ask. I'm not a very good speaker as such, but I can answer questions.
Imagine yourself when you're 11 years old going through that.
I can't.
Or like he was taking care of a
midget.
Midget. Who died in his arm.
He was very deformed, and somebody had to take care of, and that man who was in charge of us put me to help this man. I had to sleep next to him one morning. He was dead next to me. I saw death. That's unbelievable how much.
Thank you so much.
Well, if you have any questions, please, I'm here to answer, because, as I said, I'm not a very good monologue speaker, but if you ask other questions, if you have any questions, I see you have papers here.
I think you hit everything. Yeah.
No, because I was going to ask about pictures, but you brought them out, and I was like, wow.
Well, that's the main picture, That's my family before the war. There's a family. Oh, there's one more.
You should take pictures.
Yeah, I was planning on it. You got them already?
I could take an actual picture of them.
Yeah,
I was thinking too, I think we should have her sit with him for a little.
Yeah, we could take a picture of them. We could take a picture of them.
Or even a video, just zoom in and out kind of thing. Do you know what I mean?
Cool.
And a picture. Just get both. Because I didn't really get a lot of you guys. In
That's my.
Yeah, I hope. Okay.
Current
it's mostly just him.
Noah.
Yeah.
That's my brother here. No, this one. No, that's my son.
Yeah, I was like.
No, my brother is not on this one. Yeah. That's only. Here is the other big one.
Yeah.
You have a lovely family.
And this is a big family. My brother.
That's your brother, right?
Yeah. my brother and myself and
the rest of the crew.
Yeah.
We have Noah in the back.
Take it out of the glass because you
get
the reflection.
Yeah, you
Ellie,
have to
put
it out.
All of the pictures?
Yeah, I can
do pictures. Because I was going to.
Would you like a cookie?
Anyone would like a soda or something to drink?
Oh, I'm good, thank you.
Thank you so much. Can I request a few shots?
I don't know if I give you everything that you asked for, but if you have any questions. Like,
yeah, I'm trying to see if there's anything you didn't hit already on here.
Because this is basically just the...
I think Tessa's a question.
Yeah, I'm just curious how this entire, your entire story and your scenario has, how that's changed, like your faith and your belief in any God or higher power, because I know like my...
Faith?
Your faith, like your religion... And
I lost it. I'm
completely.
Sorry. I always say when my mother and my sister and my grandmother and the rest of the family went into the gas chamber, where was God? We are God-fearing people. We are religious. Not overly religious, but normal religious people who once went to temple once a week or something like that. Where was God when they burned my mother? That's the only question. Would you have an answer for it? Mm. I asked the rabbi once and he couldn't answer me.
Mm. Yeah, I read it was about somebody who had etched into a wall during the Holocaust and they wrote, God will have to beg for my forgiveness.
Everyone reacts to it. Some people became
very religious.
Some people lost it. My father lost it. My father was also in Auschwitz. And everyone is different.
It's true.
But I also have to tell you that some of the twins, that the ones who were executed, are in mental institution.
Yeah, he had it very lucky.
They couldn't, a lot of people couldn't cope with it. And as they say, he got freed, liberated, freed, but he's never free. Mm. Because he still has nightmares. And it not only affects the survivor, but it affects the whole family of the survivor.
From what I can tell you,
those
are lovely.
Hmm?
Do you want to?
I can tell you're lovely.
No, but my kids, Noah's mother, many times heard him scream. I heard my father scream. So everything is like, I'm not supposed to throw out any old food, dry food, because that would have meant life. So your whole, everything
changes. Mentality of food as such, you can't waste it. When you didn't have food for 8 or 9 months and every night you went to bed hungry, not bad, it's the preach or something like that. You have a feeling for the food,
respect.
Respect, yeah. Mm. Respect.
So grateful.
And my mother, who also was hiding during the war, and was she, on the other hand, had abundance food on the table for us that no one should go hungry. Mm. Okay, so there were the two opposites. Mm-hmm. Peter said, don't waste it, you know, just have the exact amount. My mother is, I don't want to say.
What you put on your plate, you finish.
Mm-hmm. So it's, as I said, everyone reacts differently.
That's true.
You have any questions, Laura?
No, I mean, I read the several. One other thing, none of that. I mean, you know, one other thing that was also really important, you know, we say that it was horrible that he was experimented on, but that was also kind of the reason he was able to live, because otherwise he would have gone right into the crematorium.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Right, that's the only thing that I know in life.
Yeah, and he's also very lucky, because Mengele did his experiments, you know, he put needles into people's eyes, inject things into the most obscure places, torture twins, dwarves.
Sew two kids together
makes Siamese.
That's not in my time, that was long before.
Yeah, so it was way before that, so because they went to Hungary later, that was also good. Mengele also liked, you know, my grandfather had a good, great knowledge of classical music, of soccer. He spoke German because he had a German nanny. And Mengele kind of liked him, in a sense. Took to him a little more.
No, it's not. It's
wasn't
a,
it?
He spoke, most of the twins over there spoke not very good German. But since I had a German nanny at one time, we spoke the what they call the Hochdeutsch, the best German. So he appreciated it. And when he was whistling some music, we were able to identify what it is. I'm a big music lover, so.
It was also a major deal that when, you know, he returned to the camp, you know, whatever Jewish people were left went to their synagogue, and they were the first people to have, him and his brother, to have a bar mitzvah when they got back. A couple years after, and that was like a major deal that, you know, Hitler tried to destroy this entire culture, this religion, and all the people, but, you know, we won. We were able to keep it alive.
Yeah, yeah.
Why is
Rihanna
doing this? Why?
He's helping with the talk.
Could we get a picture of the three of you?
Yeah, do you three want to sit or something? Like, if
you, would you mind?
Me too.
Yeah, yeah, you and your grandma and grandpa.
It's an honor and exemption. Number two.
You'll get
behind. I'm going to do like a video thing too.
All right. I have to know how to do this. But...
you have a family thing that you have to joke about and otherwise you cry.
Yeah.
Do you want us to take a picture of all of you with him?
Could yes, you? I would like to.
Should I keep this recording?
Yeah, whatever. Could we can we'll edit it.
Yeah. It's almost like an hour of recording straight.
It's okay. Izzy, do you want to? You can do that.
Yeah. And you too.
It's okay. I was like,
are you sure, Izzy?
Yeah.
I can take
it. Yeah, it's not ready.
Sorry about the noise.
Okay,
yeah,
that's
okay.
That looks so.
It's a good picture.
Sounds
like you're getting
into
the
food.
Okay.
Oh no, I blinked.
No,
yeah. I don't even know your school, but you know it's good. Okay.
What time?
Visiting.
First, we'll do this one.
Okay, no, you come with a picture also. Can you
okay.
Take
it?
What?
Fire.
Okay.
I mean, I can see a little longer.
Not arguing.
She's not.
Just touch herself. You have the same actions.
Nope. No.
Jared.
Is it really
unfreezing?
That's a cool. Yeah, touch the screen. You get it?
Yeah. Just quiet. Use it. Quiet.
Sorry.
I just hope I didn't disappoint you because
oh,
I'm
no.
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 Really appreciate
thank
it.
Thank you so much.
Thank
you
very much.
Thank you so much.
I have to go after these cookies. Come on.
It's just a shot of Lydia's butt right now.
Yes, they are. Yes, they are. Yes, they are.
Oh, God.
One for the road.